and night, in steady rhythm, there operates within the human body a marvelous machine, the heart.
On October 9th, 2017, I drove down to a clinic in Palo Alto with my dad, where I was supposed to have a regular physical exam with my pediatrician. Everything was normal up until the doctor took out a stethoscope to listen to my heart. He listened for a while and kept going back to hear things again. It didn't really worry me because I felt fine and wasn't having any problems, so I didn't think much of it.
He told me that I had a heart murmur that was not previously there and that it probably wasn't something to worry about, but he was going to refer me to a cardiologist anyway to get it looked at, just to be sure. So we scheduled an appointment for October 24th and just carried on normal life. Going to school, going to the movies, hanging out with friends, just my usual activities. When October 24th finally arrived, my mom and I drove down to our clinic, where I was to meet with a cardiologist for about an hour. I walked into the room, shook his hand, and sat down. He told me that he was just going to have a listen and maybe run a few tests to figure out what was going on. I was fine with that and let him do whatever he needed to. He listened to my heart and did an EKG, which records the electric activity of the heart and helps to detect any problems. After that, he wanted to do an echocardiogram, which is an ultrasound of the heart that checks how the heart's chambers and valves are pumping blood throughout. A tech came in and did the ultrasound, and the doctor spent about an hour or so looking over all the data. After spending what felt like an eternity waiting, the doctor came in and gave us the news. He believed that I had a heart defect abbreviated as Al-Kappa and would need to have open heart surgery to get it repaired. Basically, Al-Kappa is when the left coronary artery, which carries all the blood to the heart, begins from the pulmonary artery instead of the aorta.
He's lived 17 years with his left main coronary artery instead of coming off of the left sinus of Valsalva of the aortic, you know, of the sinuses of the aorta, it's coming off of the pulmonary artery.
Okay.
So that's what Al-Kappa stands for. And the surgery, which is pretty straightforward, it's what I explained to you, but some of the risks involved with that, right, because he has never had a strong antegrade pulsatile, or maybe not pulsatile, but a good, you know, antegrade flow of his left coronary artery system. It's always been retrograde. It's always been backwards.
Okay.
I really didn't know how to process this news. It came out of nowhere and didn't make sense to me. I never had chest pains, never had trouble breathing, didn't really have any symptoms other than my heart would occasionally beat really fast and aggressively, though it never really worried me. It was a big surprise to my family and I just didn't really know what to do or how to feel. A day later, on October 25th, I drove to school in the morning like I always did and told my friends what was going on. They were just as surprised as I was. I went to my first period class, Human Bio, where we were, of course, learning about the cardiovascular system. Great. Though I was scared, I tried to only think positive thoughts and even joke around a little bit. Halfway through the class, the phone rang and my teacher picked it up. He told me that I would need to go to the office because I was going home early. I got up, grabbed my exit pass, and drove home to my parents, who were on the phone with relatives, letting them know what was going on. When they got off the phone, they told me that we were going to have to go down to Stanford to get some tests done. The first test was a CT scan with angiogram, which is an imaging test that looks at the arteries that supply blood to the heart and all the vessels around it. A warm dye was injected into my bloodstream to help the doctors clearly identify which part of the heart needed to be repaired. It wasn't what I would call fun, but it didn't take too long, so I guess it wasn't that bad. After the test, my family and I drove home to find that my car, which was parked on the side of the house, had been hit while we were gone. The mirror had been knocked off and there was a giant scrape across the fender. Luckily, the person who hit the car left a note and everything was later taken care of, though it was a really big pain and just bad timing. A couple days later, on October 27th, I went back to Stanford for a cardiac MRI. The test would measure the pressures of the ventricles of all the chambers of the heart and would provide doctors with some really clear images. I went into the large spinning machine for several hours and had to occasionally breathe in and out and make sure I didn't make any movements, which was harder than it sounds. Luckily, I was able to watch Ant-Man while all this was going on, so that was a plus. 4 days later, on October 30th, I had to drive my dad's car to school because mine was in the shop getting fixed. I knew that I was going to have to leave school early for an appointment where I would get a Holter monitor put on. A Holter monitor is a small device that fits in your pocket and is connected to several electrodes that stick to your chest and record the heart throughout normal activities. This provides doctors with more information on how your heart is functioning. When I got the call that it was time to leave, I hopped in my dad's car and tried to start it up, but it didn't work because the battery was dead. Of course. My dad drove his work car over and tried to jumpstart it, but nothing was working, so we just left it there. We drove over to the hospital where I was given the monitor, and because I had to have it on for 24 hours, that meant I would need to wear it to school
and on Halloween. On October 31st, I went to school and covered all the wires from the Holter monitor up with a large jacket that I didn't wear too often. Because it was Halloween, people at school thought I was dressed up as a greaser, but I obviously wasn't. All these tests were taken because the cardiologist wanted to gather as much data as possible before he went and presented my case to a team of surgeons and heart specialists. About 30 people attended the meeting, and they determined that I would indeed need to have open heart surgery to get the Alcapa heart repaired as soon as I could. Because I had been living with this defect for 17 years, part of my left ventricle was damaged due to the lack of oxygenated blood flow and can never be recovered, so it was best to get it done as soon as possible before it got any worse. The earliest date for surgery was January 4th, but I was also added to a waitlist in case there were any sooner dates that opened up. I was definitely nervous, but felt like I could relax because the surgery wasn't for a couple of months. But about a week later, we got a call from the hospital where they told us that there was an opening on November 28th to have the surgery. My parents sat me down and asked me what I thought about the change. I really didn't want to have the surgery on that date because it would mess up my grades, being that finals is always in December and would of course get in the way of Christmas. But honestly, it was just way too soon and I wasn't ready for it. After talking about it for a really long time, we came to the conclusion that it was the best time to do it and that it was much more important than anything else going on in my life. I met with the doctor who would be performing the surgery and had the opportunity to ask him any questions I had. About a month later, on November 28th, it was time to have the surgery. We drove to the hospital early in the morning and I was really anxious but tried not to show it. I knew my parents and the rest of my family were freaking out and I didn't want them to see me scared. I walked into the hospital, filled out some forms, changed into the hospital clothes, and was given anesthesia to put me to sleep during the operation. The main thing I was scared of and couldn't stop thinking about for the last month was what it was going to feel like when I woke up. Like pretty much everybody else in the world, I'm not a fan of pain and knew that there was going to be a good amount of it because they needed to cut through my sternum to get to the heart itself. I was told that I would wake up with a breathing tube down my throat and many other contraptions hooked up to me, plus I would have a fresh wound and a correctly functioning heart. I laid down and tried to think happy thoughts as my mind wandered off and I finally passed out. Like I imagined, waking up was not a fun experience and was quite uncomfortable. I spent 2 days in the CVICU where I was constantly being filled with medications to help control the pain. The medications I was on caused me to have some of the worst nightmares I've ever had and made me see things that weren't really there, like colorful lights and even tarantulas when I would close my eyes. Which surprisingly didn't scare me, they were just there for some reason.
I was constantly being monitored by the doctors who at one point had to come in to check out my eyes because I was having issues seeing. My body was under a ton of stress and they wanted to make sure I didn't have any brain damage from the cardiac bypass, which was what stopped my heart during surgery to allow the surgeons to work on it. Everything eventually worked itself out and I was able to go home on December 1st. That next month or so was rough and consisted of me trying to sleep as much as I could and heal from the operation. Though it was not a necessarily fun time, it was great to be surrounded by the people that really cared about me and helped me through everything. My parents and brother were honestly amazing and kept me from going insane. They helped me shower, took me on walks, brought me food, watched movies with me, took care of every single thing I needed, and really just made everything as easy as it could be for me. My mom set up a Facebook support group where she could post updates on what was going on with me so our family and friends could be there throughout the process and leave me really encouraging messages. By the time Christmas came around, I was feeling a lot better and was definitely able to move around a little bit more. It had been about a month since the operation, and I honestly just couldn't believe I was there. Flash forward 10 months, and now I'm in college.